We are 100 days away from the start of the NFL season. We might go visit some of these teams here next month. That would be fun. Is it June yet?
Almost. A couple days.
Oh, really? Still? Okay, well, we're here after a super long weekend. We got 4 days off, so we are ready to go and have great shows with great attitudes all week long here on the program. Gronk will be in tomorrow. Today we have our good friend Darius. Oh, my gosh, Miami won. He's going to be insufferable.
Oh, yeah. He's going to have the foam finger. He's going to have everything.
I can't wait to talk to him. And we have Kevin O'Connor from The Ringer, who, I mean, he's basketball, like, living plus from Succession, basketball plus. Like, he is going in. He's got lots to going on and lots to share about the upcoming finals and what he thinks about the Celtics. Rough weekend for Bill Simmons with all that ending. Okay, let's go. It's hard to nail a finale.
Yeah.
It's hard to do, especially in television or any sort of streaming platform, because you never know how many, you want to get re-upped and re-upped and re-upped, and then you have to add storylines, and you want another season. They just wanted four. Jesse just wanted four.
Yeah.
And this is the ending that we got from Succession, so if you haven't seen it, don't listen to this. I don't know, I'm not saying it was like Game of Thrones ending, you know, changes the way I look at the entire franchise. It's still my favorite show I've ever watched, but
Yeah. You
know this, I invest in so few shows. I never watch anything most people are watching, so this one for me, I really wanted a different ending, but I can't tell you what I wanted.
That's
but
what
Tom
makes it
having
hard.
Power, cringe.
I'd give it like a B ending, because it wasn't supposed to be, it's not supposed to be satisfying. That's the whole point of the show, I feel like, is it's not supposed to be satisfying. There's no cute bow to wrap everything up with. It's messy, it's ugly,
and but Shiv just taking, like, the I'm gonna sit, be in the car waiting for my CEO hubby, like, what are we doing?
But that's not...
What are we doing,
you know,
Siobhan?
That's not gonna last like that. You see it in her eyes, in her face. She's not gonna be able to put up with that forever, you know?
I don't like it. And then
the story will continue.
It's so sad.
Yeah.
It's like the whole, like Logan vibe, and he's just sitting there by the water, and it's just sad.
It was
sad. He looked like Bill Simmons watching the Celtics.
Yeah. And, Roman wearing the boy shirt from Walmart. It's the little details that people find, too.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh, and the whole stitches thing. Like,
yeah.
He needs to feel pain, and, like, Jeremy Strong gave him that. It's all gross to me. But anyway, Succession's over. Now I'm, like, at a loss of what to do, what to watch.
I know.
Like, Greg also didn't play a big enough role in the finale, which I thought he would. But I had the right idea. They're going to put somebody who's servile, and they did that with Thomas.
The sticker moment was a nice moment.
What sticker? Oh, the sticker on his head moment?
Yeah.
I hated that. I hated the fight in the bathroom, the whole thing. but now I don't know what to do with myself, because I'm not that... I guess I'm into the Nuggets Heat.
Yeah.
Sure, I'll watch those games. I mean, last night was terrible. What an awful game that was.
Yeah, with all the drama build-up.
Yeah.
Wanted something better, but...
I wanted the history to break. Charles Barkley was telling me that they were going to win, so I was, like, really invested, and that didn't happen. But now I need something to watch. Is there any other television program?
There's a void right now.
Yeah. Sopranos? Never watched it?
You gotta do it.
Mm,
it's time.
Not happening. Listen.
You sat next to Bobby Bacala at a Knicks game. You have to watch it now.
That's
the rule.
The NFL's kind of like Succession. And a lot of drama in the front office and all of that's going on in Arizona. Right?
Yeah.
That could be a whole show and clown show in and of itself. And I'm not calling the Arizona Cardinals a clown show. I'm saying that's from... It's actually from Succession when they're picking a president. Season 3. Okay.
Yeah.
DeAndre Hopkins, I'm going to say it's quietly. And granted, I was away for the weekend, but I hear when things happened or there's like, oh, this might happen before the weekend. They outright released him. That's a little crazy to me. And there, you'd think there were other options. They could try to find somebody to trade with. And this isn't, I guess this is official, huh? All right.
It's not totally official yet. So apparently they haven't put in the paperwork. So there's a small, tiny chance that they could make a trade before 4 p.m. today. But it sounds like as of 4 p.m. today, it'll be official.
Well, either way, the sweepstakes are on for one DeAndre Hopkins. And there's two teams that probably have some interest. Albert Breer saying the Chiefs, the Chiefs and the Bills, they were the two teams to sort of engage in trade talks for him before this release. And I would think that means they'll both be interested now that he's on the available open market and they can just make deals with him directly now. I made my case with the Bills and I said this is where he needs to go. They should get aggressive for him and his services. Their passing numbers fell off a cliff in a weird way. And Josh Allen ranked 22nd passer rating over the second half of the season following Halloween. So I think we are going to see a lot more teams get involved now that he's on the open market than the Chiefs, than the Bills. And they're going to have to start figuring that out. And they don't have to worry about navigating what was a nearly $30 million cap hit. I mean, he's not going to be, like, on sale now.
No, he's still going to get a big deal. But that $30 million cap hit, it puts teams in a rough spot because you either have to deal with that and make room for that, or you have to rework a deal and make a big commitment to him going forward.
So, yeah, let's take a look at what some of the teams that are rumored as potential landing spots for DeAndre have in terms of space right now. Go for it.
Yeah, so you got the Lions with around $24 million to play with. The Jameson Williams suspension has people speculating that they might get aggressive, make a move like this. The Ravens, almost 12 mil. Lamar did have DeAndre on his list, apparently. He wanted the Ravens to sign Nuke and OBJ before he signed his extension, so you wonder if they're still in play. The Cowboys have 10.6 million. Trio of DeAndre, CeeDee Lamb, and remember, Brandon Cooks is there now. That could be exciting. The Jets only have a little over 6 million to play with.
That would be crazy.
But Hopkins did say he wants a great quarterback defense. And a great defense, so yeah. And okay. Then the Bills and Chiefs don't have a lot of money. That's what's interesting there. They're the two teams that we know for sure are interested, but they're at the bottom of that list.
Do you think that's what he wants? What's driving him? He wants a great defense and a great quarterback. That doesn't sound like I want a big bag of money. That sounds like I want to win a Super Bowl.
Yeah, and I'm sure he's not going to take too much of a discount. I'm sure he still wants to get paid in some form, but...
Okay, Giants don't have a ton of space. I would like that move, too. I would like to see the Giants maybe take a look. The Bills, listen... I still remain, they should get him, be the most aggressive of everybody. But the Ravens thing.
It's interesting.
I'm always for Ravens adding receivers. And yes, they did it a lot, and they've added a ton. And, you know, we've got OBJ and Bateman. But given their injury histories that are a thing, if I'm Eric DaCosta, and I always like to pretend that I am, and he happens to hate that I like to pretend that I am, listen, and if I'm DeAndre Hopkins, the chance to get to play in this offense, in this new offense, by the way, more passing, less running, says Lamar himself, right? With a former MVP, a guy who could be an MVP easily again and do it in a whole different way this year, Beckham, Mark Andrews, that's pretty sexy.
Yeah, it has to be an attractive option to him. We know he loves Lamar, too. We know that's one of the quarterbacks he talked about playing with. So, again, it's going to be a money thing. They don't have a ton to play with, but I think they could make it happen, and I think that gets interesting. There's another team to me that I think would be really intriguing and make a lot of sense. I think the Cowboys. And I know he's kind of been back and forth on Dak. He's worked out with Dak in the past, DeAndre, but he had some kind of negative things to say about him more recently. So I don't know where he stands, but remember, Dak tied for the league lead with 15 interceptions last year. As you said time and time again, this offense hasn't been the same since Amari Cooper left. And they have a top five defense as well, don't forget. So they have that. And I think if you're the Cowboys, if you're not going to go all in right now, when is it going to happen? They have so many pieces. This could be the piece that puts them in contention in the NFC. You're competing with the Eagles. You're competing with the Niners. You need that firepower.
Who do you guys think? Let us know. At Adam Show. Ravens or Bills or Cowboys? Is there any other wild card team? Like, nobody has the money.
Yeah.
The Bills don't really have the money, honestly.
Yeah. But you know how the cap is. You can always find ways.
I wonder about the Cardinals side of this, right? Because if they had waited until after June 1st to release him, then they could have spread the cap hit over 2 years. Instead, they get the whole thing this season, which is kind of, rebuild mode entirely. Is that what we're saying? Like, they're playing the long game here. Kyler is going to miss significant time, which we know. Then we got the D-hop. Then the Cards adding the Texans' first-round pick. They could have two top 10 picks, over $60 million in cap space to play with in free agency. So we don't like to use the tank word around here, but this seems to be let's hang back here.
Yeah.
Let's just kick it.
Yeah, because, again, not knowing when Kyler's coming back, dealing with that uncertainty, dealing with some of the other roster issues they have. New coach, new GM, it's a fresh start. And, Yeah, you have to wonder if this is just really signaling, let's line things up for the future now.
What's going on, Buddha?
We'll see. I mean, it sounds like they're talking, they're trying to work something out.
At this point, trade Buddha, right?
Yeah, or...
I'm just saying get a deal done with him, but at this point, with what this team is,
He's still young, though. He could be the cornerstone you kind of build around on defense.
Or could win another team a Super Bowl this
True.
Year. Like, where could he go? Philly?
Yeah.
Can they afford him? Can they still make it work?
Because remember that Jalen Hitt isn't that big this year, so they can fit him in.
We had other news this weekend, crazily, but also, I don't think today we'll have time to get into the San Francisco side of this and how they handled it and what their hand in it. But out of Vegas, Jimmy Garoppolo, he failed his initial physical with the Raiders because of the foot injury that knocked him out last year. And that caused the deal to be reworked. And there's this addendum that says that the Raiders can move on from Jimmy G at no cost if he can't pass a physical by the time this season starts. Like, no cost. They will eat nothing. And they can just say, see ya, Jimmy G. And that's how this contract was structured. So if I'm a Raiders fan, I gotta say, like, and I love the smile, and he's great, got a great look to him. I'm a little annoyed right now. We trade away Derek Carr. We don't get aggressive to grab one of the top quarterbacks in the draft. And now there's all this uncertainty with Jimmy. He did get surgery in March, okay? So, and that's after he signed the deal. So the hope, of course, is I'll be ready, let's go. But there's no guarantees here, and Jimmy has that injury history and that weird split of games he's missed versus played and wins and whatever to deal with. And then the fun part of this, the movie part, the like what's going to take my attention from Succession ending part of this, is that there's this weird Tom Brady thing that just like hovers and looms and is always wherever Jimmy G might be, right? Because he has ties to ownership, as we know. He's got ties to Josh McDaniels and their GM. And they've got, you know, Brady's, we're all seeing what Brady probably sees. We've got Devontae Adams. We seem like we have a pretty good roster, competitive division, though, which is not something we've seen Tom Brady in for a minute. I don't know if we've ever seen him really in a super competitive division.
Yeah,
truly.
Maybe that first year dealing with Brees.
Sure.
But other than that, I think
but even
that's
back
about,
to the in the AFC East, they just sort of like did it consistently and were always on top of there was so much tumult and so much changeover and destabilization of the rest of the AFC East all those years in New England. So it'd be interesting to see him dabble in this, whether as a mentor, whether as from a leadership angle. But you know, there's a real chance here that he could weasel his way into being like, you know what, I'll own this team and I'll take over, or I'll not own this team right now and I'll play. And if people out there are wondering, is it possible for him to have any stake of ownership in a team and still play, he can, but he would have to have buy-in from all 32 teams. Everyone would have to approve it. But given what Tom Brady means as granted, like nobody, you know, like the Broncos aren't saying, yeah, that's great, let Tom Brady play, neither the Chiefs, neither. But given what he means to the team, is there a world where that is allowed? I could see it happen. I've seen everything happen.
Yeah, it's true. And even if, let's say they don't allow that to happen, and let's say Tom says, okay, I'll put my ownership on hold then, and now I'm going to come back. Now you've made me want to come back.
It's what I said all along. Tom's done.
Yeah.
He had his Baker's Bay Discovery property. Shout out to Melman. We all get it. Sean Payton, Wayne Gretzky, we love your properties. We're so great. We can't get into any of them because you guys are so fancy. We get it. Enjoy that. Live your life. Be with your kids. But the whole thing I said was, it's not going to be about Tom's mindset. It's going to be about somebody chipping away. And yes, like 8 times people will knock on your door and you will say no. That 9th time, you might just open the door. You might get a little weak. And if he's already surrounding himself and he's in Vegas and he's going to these Aces games and he's whatever, he's with Mike Evans. If he's already there, and then you have Josh McDaniels saying, Devontae.
Yeah.
Fly out to see him.
Yeah.
That will work on any human.
But we also know from the reports from what was going on in Miami that this was something that was attractive to him. The idea of becoming a player owner, the first one in this modern era, is something that's really attractive. So if there is something to lure him back in, the stage is set now for him to maybe make that a reality.
Are we bored? Is this like a total May? What is it?
It could be.
May 30th thing that we're bored?
It could be. But it's Tom.
Ramp up. Ramp up in July, I bet you. Just the Brady. And then there'll be some, we don't want it to happen, but some sort of quarterback drama whether it's by injury, whether it's by something else, that we'll think, like, oh, is this where Tom scoops in and sees? I just don't know if that's, like, the right place for him just because of the division. I do think he thinks about that. I think everyone says, like, oh, that's a loser mentality, whatever. Like, I think Tom, like, really enjoyed his, like, Eastern Seaboard, NFC, AFC vibe, where he had it nice and easy to get back to where he needed to get to win a championship. All right, we will ask Darius Butler about this. We also will talk to Kevin O'Connor from The Ringer about all things. Maybe we'll just talk about the Nuggets with Kevin O'Connor, because we know the Heat are going to be well covered and documented by this guy who's living his best life.
Let's go, Heat.
Heat down in my soul. So, yeah, I mean, we're rolling. It's not just Jimmy Butler. Obviously, it starts with him.
Unbelievable
player, but...
Where do you feel the Heat?
Down in your soul! Oh, shit, I hit that. Hey, I hit that note
you
right
hit
there.
It. You...
hey, Jimmy, you know, thank you. I appreciate that.
Down in his soul, deep down in his soul. He's going to kill me for singing it so poorly. We have our best friend. There he is, Darius. Who's living a better life than the co-host of the Man to Man podcast, a 9-year NFL cornerback who has earned this golf trip today? How are we doing, Mr. It's Mr. South Florida, everybody.
This is a celebratory golf trip right now. Win, lose, or draw, I was going to be out here. But it feels great to be out here celebrating a win, not only with the Heat, obviously huge, huge Heat for the win. Game 7, everyone loves the Game 7. We came through. I was nervous, definitely, going into it, but we got it done. And then my Panthers took care of business with the 4-0 sweep. So we got a couple of championship runs down here to start June off pretty soon here. I'm happy about it, Kay.
I was bored last night. I wasn't happy. I was so bored watching that game. All this talk about how the Celtics might win and blah, blah, hasn't happened in 150 years. It was a boring game, Darius.
For some people, I can see how it could be boring. And I did I hated the fact that Tatum got hurt on literally like his first offensive drive, first offensive play. I knew he would stay in the game and keep playing his Game 7. Unfortunately, that's a part of the game. But I think if he was healthy, you saw full speed, Tatum, it would have been a different game. But I damn sure wasn't bored. I was happy. It was Memorial Day. You know, obviously, salute. Huge honor to all the vets, especially the ones that laid it down and gave their life. Had the family over. You know, we were celebrating. Then going to that basketball game, It was great. It was a great, great moment. House full of Jimmy Butler jerseys. That's our fake cousin that we took on to the family. Got a big face. So the vibes are high right now, okay? It's good to be a South Florida sports fan right now.
They've been high
Brooks
for you.
Brooks Koepka.
They've been high for you, really.
You know,
yeah, Brooks Koepka. Shout out to Brooks Koepka.
Shout out to Brooks.
Darius, you're having the best time. Listen, I need you to take care. Like, you're obviously golfing. That's good for your mentals. We need you to, hit the sauna, the steam room. You got to get a massage, an IV maybe. You got to get set because this team needs you. On Thursday, it's Nuggets, Heat, Finals, a Joker. They have 10 days of rest. And that 7-game series could not have been easy on Miami. So, in your opinion, what do the Heat need to focus on to keep this momentum going and roll over Denver?
We just got to play Heat basketball. You know, we just got to play Heat basketball. Obviously, the culture is set by Pat Riley. And the last time I came on the show, I told you he was a part of, if not a player, a coach, or a decision maker, 25% of all NBA finals. So he's laid the foundation down for the culture. We just got to continue following Jimmy's lead on the court. Hopefully, we get Tyler Hero back. But if we get healthy and just keep playing Heat basketball, you know, we'll be all right. 10 days, hey, that's a lot of rest. It might be too much. It might be too much rest. It might be, but that's just the Heat fan of me talking. Denver Nuggets, we're going to have our hands full with Joker. He's a bully. Bam is going to have to bring his lunch pail every game of this series. But, you know, I'm going with the Heat and 7. This will be a 7-game series, Heat and 7.
Oh, wow. And let's, Darius, it's hard for me to do this as a Knicks fan, but I'm happy for you. I'm not happy for the Heat, but I'm happy for you. Let's check
Knicks
out the
fan.
Odds for those finals.
Okay. Oh, shit.
Okay.
Don't like it.
Well, you already said 7 games, so we're taking a look at the odds here. And Darius says Heat in 7.
Heat in 7 is plus 1,000, Darius.
That's pretty good.
That's pretty good for you.
Anytime I'm looking at the book, you know I'm looking for some value. That's some good value right there. Plus 1,000, and we've been getting disrespected all year long. We've been getting disrespected when the playoffs started, get disrespected when it came down to the Final Four. I think we were still plus 1,400 to win it with four teams left. Obviously, had a 3% chance to win that last series, but we did it. I like that. I like that plus 1,000, Heat and seven. Okay. I might go take that. I like that.
Listen, NBA is a game of stars, right? You have Jimmy Butler out there. You want Hero yep. back because he's the kind of guys that need to come in and make plays. In the NFL,
need him.
DeAndre Hopkins is a star. Darius, he is a star. Yep. And the Cardinals just said, bye. No trade, no, just drop him outright before Memorial Day weekend. What are your thoughts, and where do you think is the best fit for D-Hop?
I mean, you kind of saw it coming. You know, he was going and doing interviews talking about, you know, what he's looking for in his next quarterback or his next team and next front office. It's kind of like, you know, having a girl or a wife and just, you know, out here on Tinder and just swiping left, swiping right. So, you know, they dropped him. They moved on from him. I was surprised, you know, they just took that hack, the cap hit. It is an absolute shit. So I'm in Cardinals country right now. Buda Baker, he asked for a trade. If that guy's asking for a trade out of your building, something is fundamentally wrong. But I would love to see DeAndre Hopkins land in Baltimore. I would like to see him in Baltimore right now with Zay Flowers, obviously just got drafted. Odell Beckham out there fully healthy. He got a nice deal. And it seems like everything DeAndre's saying, obviously the money's important. It's always important as professional athletes. But he's been, you know, he's been the highest paid receiver before. Everything that he said, it makes it sound like he wants to go chase a championship. And I think joining Lamar Jackson and co out there in Baltimore would be the right fit for him in his next step.
I do love that fit, Darius. Kay talked about it a little bit in the opening of the show. I brought up the Cowboys mm-hmm. as a potential destination. What do you think about that?
No. I mean, I thought Hammer, you would have probably went Buffalo or Kansas City or one of these teams that's already knocking at the door every year for a Super Bowl. But Dallas, no. I just feel like that would just get their hopes even higher. We'll have to talk about it even more when they fail inevitably like they always do. So, no, I would not like to see DeAndre Hopkins in the Dallas Cowboys uniform. But they did get better with the Brandon Cooks move. Yeah. But no, Hammer, please, no, please.
They do have a top five defense. He says he wants a defense and a quarterback. I don't know. I don't know how he feels about Dak Prescott.
Yeah, he seems to have gone both ways on Dak. So
I think the Jets have no money, but if he came to New York, I'd be all for that. Then he could go to a Taylor Swift concert with Aaron Rodgers next time. But let's talk about these Panthers. We can't because you're a hockey guy. You're a sophomore. We can't just talk about. Yeah, we can't just talk about the Heat. You listen, Panthers were up 2-0. Then you go to the game with your dad, and now they're in the Stanley Cup Finals. So I think you're the good luck charm. It is your squad versus the Vegas Golden Knights. Oh, yeah. How do the Panthers match up, and what do you got on these teams?
Hey, you know, that was a special moment. That was a few days ago, Pop's birthday. 61 this year. He'll probably be mad that I said that, but whatever. He's a guy. We can say your age. 61. You know, you get a chance. We get so busy. You know, if you're lucky enough, like I am, to still have both of my parents, you got to spend that time with them. So I got the one-on-one trip with my dad to the Panthers game. We used to go to a couple games, actually, because my sister used to dance for him. But being in that environment, I've probably been to 3 or 4 hockey games. Never been to a bad hockey game in person. And that environment was just electric. 4-3 game, 4 seconds left on the clock, and Chucky knocks it in to send us to the final for the first time since 1996. I mean, it's electric down here. And I will be going at it with the Vegas Golden Knights. So Miami and Vegas, that's not too bad place to catch a Stanley Cup Finals game. So I'll be trying to catch a couple for sure.
I want to look at the odds
FanDuel,
really
I wouldn't be mind if I went. I wouldn't mind if FanDuel. Yeah. FanDuel could sponsor a trip or two or a box or give me on the glass.
Listen, we got to get him and his dad back out here. Let's take him through the odds.
Yeah, so right now it looks like the Golden Knights are the favorites in this series, but
unbelievable.
But what are you thinking? I know you're going to pick the Panthers to win. How many games do you see this thing going? A sweep gets you plus 1,200. Are you going for the sweep?
No, I don't see a sweep winning. I got too much respect for the Vegas Knights and Stoner over there. But I will go with my Panthers 4-2. I like them 4-2. So I'll take the Panthers at 6, which is like plus 450. We're rested, yeah. Kind of like the difference. So now I'm going to switch my stance to rest. Vegas nights, we haven't even been on first. So I'm going to Panthers at 6, first Vegas upon long trips too. Long, you know, back home, long way to Vegas. I'm going to my first long trip. So now my Panthers. We just seem like a team that just, you know, 8-7, just like
we love it.
Fresh and clean against the great Boston Bruins. Wipe the ice with them. So I like us to finish this 4-2. Back home. You know, all ice. So yeah, give me a Panthers.
There we go. Plus 450 is what Conrad's telling me in my ear. Darius, go enjoy golf. You've had a beautiful weekend with your family. Keep it going. Final start on Thursday. We love to see it.
If PJ Brown doesn't pull that in 97, the Knicks go to the finals, and you know it.
Hey, Wes,
no one's having a better offseason than Darius Butler. We salute you, DB, RDB, here on the show. Listen, if Kendall Roy only went down to South Florida,
yeah,
he would have won Succession. That's what I mean. They cannot lose right now, especially if you got this guy cheering for you. We will be back right here with Kevin O'Connor to talk. Maybe we'll talk a little Nuggets instead of the Heat. Maybe just a little bit. Do I like Shiv and Tom together? No, that's why I'm the best matchmaker there is. They should not be together. They probably won't be together, and they shouldn't be, but we are all about matchmaking. Like DeAndre Hopkins, I think he should go to the Ravens. I know people are saying Bills and Chiefs, they don't have the money. They can't afford the size ring that the guy wants on his finger. So it's probably not going to happen. Jets have no money either. Neither the Giants. Those would be interesting. You think Cowboys, though Darius Butler literally ended your dream by going, no.
He doesn't like it because he doesn't believe in the Cowboys. That was the premise, I think, on his end.
Yeah.
He wants to see DeAndre go somewhere where he really thinks he can win a Super Bowl. He doesn't believe it's Dallas. I think he could give Dallas a legitimate shot to come out of the NFC.
What does DeAndre Hopkins going to the Ravens do to their odds in the AFC? Like, does it really put them, you're going to put them above Buffalo? Are you going to put them above New York?
That's a great question.
Baltimore with DeAndre
Hopkins. And even Cincinnati
Hopkins.
Right now, because remember, Cincinnati's still ahead of them. So it has to boost them up. I think because that's
above
the one
the
thing, right? Like, we love what the Ravens have done at receiver, but there's still that question of can everybody stay healthy? They've had so you add another guy into the mix like that, it has to really boost them.
I think I heard something about a tweet about DeAndre. Let's see. My main question thought is if the Bills were trying to trade for him, does that not mean they were going to figure out a way prior to fit him in financially? If not, why else would the Bills try to trade for him? I know it's not simple, but it seems possible.
And it does seem like from the reports that we heard, it was a money thing that stalled both of those trade talks with the Bills and Chiefs.
Yeah.
It came down to it being too difficult to make his contract fit. Now, obviously, like signing a brand new deal, you get a little bit more flexibility. There are always ways, as we've talked about, to kind of manipulate the cap, and there are things the Bills can do. Yeah, it's just not simple. It'll take some cap gymnastics on their part. They could make it happen, but there are other teams that have a little bit of a cleaner path and might be able to offer him more money.
Does DeAndre Hopkins strike you as the kind of player that's going to take a little less money to be on a Super Bowl contending team?
I think at this stage of his career,
no.
A little bit less, maybe.
No way.
But not. So he's not taking a big discount.
He's not. He's just not. I think it's part of what the tumult is over there as well. I don't see that happening. So it's going to be a team that is able to get it done. Now, we were looking for new TV shows for me to watch, and Taylor asked Twitter what I should watch because Succession's over. I'm not that happy about it. I'm waiting for the prequel or the deep sequel to come out. Abbott Elementary, nope, don't know what that is. Not interested, don't like the title. Mayor of Kingstown, also, what is that?
I don't know.
Nope, no.
You don't want to watch anything about school.
Chris, not at all. Is that it? That's the only, that's how bleak it is up there? That's the only tweet we got? The only suggestion for what I should be watching?
So you gotta go back into the past now, Sopranos. You floated it out there.
Mm-mm.
It's time.
I think I should just watch movies. No?
We both know you're not gonna do that.
All right, let's see. What's this other one?
Assuming
she watched Jury Duty? Nope. What a silly assumption. Barry? No, but shout out to Winkler, who we love. Oh, that ended last night. Was that a good finale? Did we hear? That ended Sunday night, too. FUBAR on Netflix was solid. If I could find out how to log into my Netflix, then I might be able to watch that. I don't think I've logged into Netflix for 2 years. It's Arnold Schwarzenegger and Monica from Top Gun 2. Who's Monica from Top Gun 2? Seinfeld's watched it. Curb, I've seen it. Veep, I know every episode by heart. Excellent use of the F-bomb, great writing.
I love Parks and Rec, one of my favorite shows of all time. I don't think you would like it.
Why?
It's just a lot.
It's not quick enough?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see that. Shrinking, great, saw it. Truth Be Told, don't know what that is. Yeah, okay, these are good. Those are definitely more in my world. And Curb has a new season coming up. Is that the savior here? Is there a new
that
Curb?
That could be. Yeah, that could end up being the savior. But yeah, we both know the movie thing. Like Gronk asked you to watch The Longest Yard like 3 months ago.
He didn't really sell it very well. The Longest Yard.
True.
Let's do this. We've got OTAs. They're still in full swing. Last week we tried to find Carson Wentz a home on the app market that we have. It's called Yearning for Earnings is the name of the app. The app creator who will surely sell this for $1 billion and then leave our show, Marissa McBride, is here with more. Who we got today?
I didn't know I was a venture capitalist all of a sudden, but thank you for that.
Mm-hmm.
We try to give Carson some love, like we said. This time we've got Leonard Fournette, Lombardi Lenny. Oh. Let's take a look at his profile for our Yearning for Earnings. Did you know he's 28 years old? I don't know why. I thought he was so much older than 28 years old. I'm shocked by this. He's 28 years old, 6 foot. He's from New Orleans, went to LSU. We love our LSU guys. Let's get to his prompts and see what he said to sell himself. People may not know I'm one of the greatest playoff running backs of all time. They call me Lombardi Lenny for a reason. That is true. Next prompt, his greatest strength, my dual threat ability. I've eclipsed 1,190 total yards from scrimmage in 4 of my 6 years in the league. That is selling himself. I would click on that if I was a team. last prompt, the way I win you over, I'm always looking forward, never looking back. I've averaged 4 yards per carry in my NFL career. I know a couple teams that could use somebody like that. Let's look into his potential DMs. Okay, so we got some from the Jets, the Bengals, the Bucks, and the Seahawks. The Seahawks a little lonely on this rainy day. The Jets flying straight into your DMs. Okay, Jets, calm down. Let's look at the Jets and see what they actually have to say. All right, the Jets say reuniting can feel so good. Think you can hack it with your old boo Nathaniel. We're looking for some more veteran foxes behind the O-line. We'd love for Lombardi Lenny to put the L in Super Bowl LVIII.
Ooh.
Kay, the Jets are coming in hot. What do you think about that? Can he put the L in Super Bowl LVIII with them?
First of all, why are those DMs so wonderful? And why are there no people asking for photos of Leonard Fournette's feet?
Feet pics. Feetfinder.com.
Why aren't there any sweat emojis on any of those DMs? Like when you open mine up, like look at.
No. Those are PG-13.
Yeah, well,
I'm not looking down.
I'm scared for this.
That emoji.
Not doing it. I don't want to see it. I don't want to.
Okay, what about the Jets? What are we thinking?
Okay, the Jets. I'm thinking, listen, Breece Hall, we say his name like, they got Breece Hall, they got Breece Hall. Can he get back to that form that we don't really even have a huge sample size of anyway, or any sample size, really? It's a bit of an unknown. Sometimes running backs could take a little time to, you know, to get back, especially off an ACL. So I know it's kind of an old way of thinking, but I could see the fit actually working here, getting some veteran leadership. I mean, I'm looking at the running back depth here. They've got Michael Carter, they've got Knight, you know, Aaron Rodgers wasn't brought in, this big fish, to get to the playoffs. Or like, they need depth. They need a Super Bowl run out of this, you know, aging quarterback. So bring in, I don't know, one of the best performers in NFL postseason history, a strong guy that can do it all and he's versatile. I don't see why not.
Yeah, I like it. I like the fit. He also, as those DMs mentioned, the familiarity with Nathaniel Hackett, who was his OC in Jacksonville. Oh, God.
Okay, stop it.
You know, it does make a lot of sense. He'll be able to fit into that offense and that system seamlessly.
I like that from both of you, but we got one more message from the Bengals. Let's take a look at this. A nice greeting. Hi. I know you might be a little bit older for running back, but I'm into it. Word on the street is you're versatile and ready to flex on a lot of fantasy rosters. You used to be a Tiger. Why don't you come burrow with the Bengals in Cincinnati? Ooh, attractive. Oh. They're coming off a little despy, though, Hamilton. What do you think about the Bengals?
It's an interesting fit because obviously they still have Joe Mixon there, but they lost Samaje Perine in free agency, don't forget, to the Broncos, and he played a really big role for them, especially on third downs. And I think the one part of Leonard Fournette's game that is a little bit underrated is his ability to catch the ball.
Over
the last 2 years, only Austin Eckler has had more catches from the running back spot than Leonard Fournette. So I think he can fill that role, and if, you know, knock on wood, something does happen to Mixon, we know he's a guy who can carry a full workload. So I like the idea of this for the Bengals.
We really always like a little insurance. It doesn't seem like the risk is super high in bringing a guy like Fournette in. And the age thing is real. I mean, he wears that 28, but he is just 28 years old. Obviously, injuries have been a concern. He's accomplished a lot in his career. And at that position, you're sort of punished for that as well. But I'd like to see all of that happen. And then, yeah. That'd be really nice, a nice little situation. I like the DMs. Who's writing these DMs, Marissa? This is very well done.
You know Eric's writing these. These are too good. These are too funny to be anybody else but him. He's doing so well with them. Are we swiping right on the Bengals? Is that our choice?
Ooh.
Jets or Bengals?
Best fit. I don't know. Let's leave it to Twitter. I think we both laid out really strong cases. I don't know. Yeah. I mean, Mixon and Fournette, it's insurance, right? But yeah. I will say this, Leonard Fournette's coming on our show, so we'll ask him on Thursday. Yeah. So he'll be joining us,
and
we're excited to see all of that. Now, Marissa, you somehow escaped all of our BS talking about Succession all the time this whole season without watching it because you're like, no, I'm not doing it. Give me a show I need to watch.
I have told you this from the day I met you. You need to watch Sopranos. It's a must. It's an absolute must. It's my favorite show. It's all of our favorite shows. It's a classic.
Your favorite?
Yeah. It's my favorite show. Carmela Soprano, she is a queen. And you need
to watch
her.
But she's just going to cause me relate. She's a queen who gets cheated on all the time. I don't need to see that.
It's deep.
Into, like,
it's
all
convoluted.
The bad things in my head.
It's a lot. It's not just about that. It's great. It's about gangsters that go to therapy. Come on.
But I wish Carmela killed him.
Oh, my God.
I like Carmela to kill him.
Listen to the people.
Watch Sopranos, one of the best series ever made, as well as Breaking Bad, never Breaking Bad. See, people who like The Sopranos like Ozark and Breaking Bad. Ozark, I fell asleep in. And then Breaking Bad, you lost me in Breaking Bad when the guy, there's, like, early on, there's a man who gets killed, and they put him in a bathtub, and it's full of acid, and he falls through the ceiling. And
one time.
I just don't need that in my life.
Just one time.
It's just once. You can deal with that one time.
It's totally fine.
If Carmela got revenge on Tony, I'd be into it. But I just know all the little clips I see, I'm like, Carmela, poor Carmela.
It's deep,
but
it's heavy.
She has her own hand in things, too.
Yeah.
Carmela's a complicated character. They're all complicated characters, and that's what makes it great.
Mm-mm.
I don't want to give away any spoilers right now.
Well, she should.
But.
And The Wire, okay?
Furio.
The Wire,
there's the whole Furio situation.
Don't get me started
on
Furio.
Into,
I love Furio.
And then there's the. she's swiping right on Furio.
Absolutely.
And we're taking a break here.
It's
at
the ponytail.
We will be back. Do not go anywhere. Hopefully, we have Kevin O'Connor on, who's big timing us, which is hilarious. We'll be back after this, right here. Where should Leonard Fournette go? What team should he sign up with? He's a free agent. He's 28 years old. He's versatile. He can do the damn thing. He's got that Super Bowl pedigree. You know Tom Brady's, like, on the top of his referral recommendation list on his CV.
Yeah.
Like, that's like, call him, tell him how, ask him how, what I can do for your team. Where should he go? Let us know at Up and Adam Show. We did a Carson Wentz on Friday, on Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
What were our options?
We talked Packers.
Yeah.
And we talked Rams.
Packers to back up Jordan Love, I said, was a swipe no. Like, I just think it's a little too much drama. Let Jordan Love do his thing. Let Love happen.
Yeah.
And what did you make of the other one?
I like the Rams as a fit. I think, you know, with Stafford, some of the concerns that we had with his elbow, with some of the other injuries, I think that's a good option to bring in there. And I think Sean McVay can really make the most of his skill set.
I think the Rams are just sitting pretty. They're, like, still, like, I know that they're not, kind of, but, like, they won this thing. Now Stan Kroenke's, like, all steam ahead for the Nuggets to get there. I mean, this is their first time to the finals ever.
Yeah.
That's insane. And then, you know, he's just sort of hoping that they win. And if they win, it takes all the pressure off them.
Yeah, that's
at least from the top down.
Yeah,
I'm still in the Succession mind frame of like what really matters from the top down with this stuff. But let us know what you guys think as far as Carson Wentz. People, such a polarizing character still.
Yeah, yeah,
it's crazy.
And there's even rumors about the Cowboys out there with him, which could give him three of the four NFC East teams.
Yeah, I wonder if when he works out, are guys like, man, he's so freaking good. We have to like, and then you have this weight of what he can. You know, it's a. Yeah. And you have to process the injury built-in issue with all of that. Yeah. When it comes to these free agent quarterbacks, they're like, who else is available? Like, we're talking Jimmy G and potentially being dropped with no cost to the Raiders if he doesn't pass another physical.
Yeah.
He failed his initial one. That was weird news over the weekend. But then who do you grab? Like, what do you do if you're the Raiders? Do you go looking for Teddy Bridgewater?
Matt Ryan
Tom
is
Brady,
still out there?
Obviously.
Yeah. So it's, yeah, I mean, it's not the best. To me.
Cam Newton?
Yeah. I mean, to me, it's like, I know, like, a lot of people have very strong feelings about Carson Wentz, but we've seen the talent level. I mean, you look at that. Last year, he was hurt. You look at the year in Indy, it ended so terribly, and we know there was stuff going on yeah. in the locker room that we don't know about yeah. that rubbed people the wrong way, but he had a good year overall. And obviously, there's the clip we showed, which everybody harps on. It was a horrendous decision. But overall, you look at the body of work that year. If you protect him, if you put him in the right offense with a run game, he can win you some games.
Yeah, it's so funny because, like, Howie saw something in him. You know, we believe yeah. in Howie. Howie goes to, the you know, the little town, the little diner to meet with him and figure out, you know, are you going to be our franchise guy? And then it sets into motion this disaster that leads to a Nick Foles Super Bowl, that leads to a Jalen Hurts draft choice, that leads yeah. to another Super Bowl appearance and likely another Super Bowl appearance after that. So it's super interesting to think about where he can go and what role he plays in all of this.
And the other interesting element of the Rams thing, too, they passed him over to take Jared Goff in that same draft class. They had the number one pick. Carson Wentz went two to the Eagles.
So. And now Jared Goff just won the NFC North. Oh, wait, that didn't happen yet. Everyone just thinks it's going to. We'll take a break here, and we will be back because we wanted to talk about Taylor Swift again. Taylor Swift gets more airtime on our show than anyone.
Did you see the Ice Spice performance?
No. I was gone for the weekend, and I come back, and Josh Allen's just casually dating Hailee Steinfeld.
It seems like that.
Seen on dates? Yeah. I don't care that they're dating or anything about it. I want to know where he took her. Like, People Magazine, love you. Do a little better job. Like, tell me, I need to know. And that's what I do whenever I see these things. I'm like, what is the restaurant that they're at? Where exactly? It looks like Hudson Yards, maybe? That, like, Greek place where they bring you the fish and the salt? I don't know.
I don't know how you could tell that from that picture. But.
I don't know what, I don't know how, I, but Josh Allen, the catch. 26, 27, successful, affable, everyone likes him,
yeah.
boy's boy, rumored bad boy. Like, he's a catch, that Josh yeah. Allen. Aaron Rodgers, another quarterback in the news, and he'll be yeah. in the news every day until he stops playing, and then he'll probably find his way into the news again.
Yeah.
Everyone's freaking out over this, that he's, everyone knows he's a Swiftie. Listen, he was engaged to Shailene Woodley, which is, by the way, how he knows these people, Miles Teller, his wife, whatever. And there's all that footage of him singing Taylor Swift songs in the kitchen, and everyone freaked out about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
What, is it just, like, not cool to like Taylor Swift? So I don't understand. What is that? Why is it, what's the obsession with NFL players, Mac Jones and Taylor Swift? And
I guess for a male athlete to lean into Taylor Swift, there's still that perception, you know. But, yeah, I feel like we've advanced past that as a society.
Yeah, this is, we're going to just normalize this right here. This is yeah. a non-story, but he did manifest something. Let me hear this.
Threw me.
What?
Ruth Langmore from Ozark is
oh,
in
okay.
there, too.
I like her.
Mix.
Her yeah. I like. When I said
Not
that mean,
surprising.
When I said that mean thing... When I said that new thing about how Ozark was kind of boring to me,
yeah.
I thought, oh, but that actress with the banana curls, I think she's really fantastic actress. I feel bad for saying that.
Yeah. No, she is fantastic.
Is she rumored to be dating Aaron Rodgers now, too?
Not that I'm aware of.
Oh, I love this. Love it. As the NFL world turns. You only get that kind of information here. Go tell your teenage daughter about Josh Allen and...